I'm Andy Piazza, Killer Grizz. I'm the head of threat intel for IBM X-Force. Today's talk is clearly kind of a pun on a CTI world, kind of our words, right? I will say I feel what I assume Joe Slowick feels like right before he drops a fire meme to Twitter, because I'm going to make fun of us a lot today. I love threat intel and I hate threat intel. There's a lot of folks that are doing it really well. There's also a lot of us that are doing it really poorly. I kind of want to talk about that today. I also have to say, I normally try to separate out what we do on the vendor side of threat intel from the defender side. And we've heard a lot of really cool defender talks. And I mean, you're implementing threat intelligence in a SOC or in an enterprise versus being on the CISA side or NSA side or, you know, IBM or Mandiant side where we're producing intel. There's a big difference about how we do intel and what our role really is. And I don't think we talk about that enough. And I've heard some really cool talks about how we're implementing stuff. That's also important as I try to separate out my thoughts on some of these slides. But before I get into it, I want to hear from a master spy, their thoughts. Okay, really ultimately, if you retitled the whole talk, it's like words matter, or, you know, phrasing. So the first kind of fallacy I came up with, I want to talk about is kind of intent focus, right? With threat intel, we're really focused on intent capability. This one kind of impacts how we understand intent. One, I think, as a community, we do a pretty poor job actually talking about targeting. We kind of seem to forget to talk about like the whole spectrum of targeting, where everything just comes off of, like, I don't know about you, I hear the word targeting, I think super bullseye, like that was, they wanted that organization, they wanted that user, they wanted those creds, whatever. And that completely misses like the whole spectrum that there's target of opportunity, right? Someone's got a whole list of emails to fish, someone's got a vulnerability that they can scan for. The reality is most of the activity that most organizations see is not super targeted, yet that's how we often interpret that word. And when we see that is, gets even worse when we start talking about derivative reporting. So you read the original source and then you read something that was picked up in InfoSec News, or you repackage it for your consumers, and you may have lose some of the language that the original source had about what they actually observed. So we go from something like, I saw, you know, we saw a campaign impacted someone in finance. By the time that thing gets repackaged three times, it's like, finance is being targeted, right? We see it all the time, and no one really goes back to that original source to actually assess like what was actually said. So we see that in derivative reporting. We see that in threat actor profiles. I feel bad I forgot to include the source here. I think this might be the TyCerts profile. I will include that in the Slack link when I'm done. But here is just a quick snapshot of a threat actor profile, and they show the sectors. That's just like a comma separated list now, right? That has the same weight as if one of those sectors was specifically targeted by that group and the other one just was tangentially hit. But now those industries are all listed with the same weight. So if you go to do your threat model for your organization, you're like, which things do we need to prioritize for detection engineering or hunting? Which groups should we care about? And you're going to this list because you're not going to the original reporting. Why would you? There's thousands of these damn reports. For each actor, you're going to go to this industry list and go, there's my industry. Okay, I'm going to add them. And now you're racking and stacking potentially the wrong groups, right? Cool, you might end up with a signature in place for a group you don't care about. There's no real harm there, except for what if that's the one you prioritize and you're actually getting hit by someone that you haven't written a rule for while you're writing the wrong rules, right? So downstream stakeholders, we need to understand what the actual intention was observed by the original reporter. If you are writing incident response reports or threat intel reports or blogs, you need to actually explain what you meant by the targeting, right? Or if you thought it was targeted. And I think we need to add that to our assessments. And I'll show you an example first. I keep forgetting I get the clicker. I'm not used to this. So again, I was really glad to see a bunch of different CISA reports today. I picked on CISA as well. Figured they're less likely to sue an individual than if I used a vendor report. But vendors were guilty of this too. You see this here in the title. Targeting, right? Those little red highlights I added, whole bunch of targeting language, then immediately gets into technical details. At no point in here does CISA, FBI, or HHS actually explain why they believe that healthcare was being targeted by ransomware. Is this likely true? Maybe. But without those details, we don't know if those analysts made an appropriate threat assessment based off of, you know, chat data, dark web, you know, super spooky TSSCI stuff because they read Google. We don't know actually how they came to that assessment. All we know is they believe that healthcare is being targeted by ransomware. Well, we also know there's been a boatload of ransomware events in hospitals over the last 3 years. Is that why they called it targeting? Just because hospitals were being impacted? we don't know, and that's going to lead a bunch of false assessments. Should hospitals prioritize for against ransomware? Absolutely. But we as intel analysts, we owe it to our consumers to tell them why we think what we think, right? So this is just one example. Like I said, you can not take my word for it. Who's this weird guy dancing on stage, and go do your own research. It is very rare that you will find in a threat intel report where we actually talk about why we made the targeting assessment. We'll make really big, bold assessments about what the future looks like, but not the past. That's kind of weird to me. So some of the impacts, like I said, prioritizing the wrong projects, prioritizing the wrong resources. Also, if you're on the vendor side, especially if you're anybody from CISA, right? I'm US CERT alumni as a contractor. Understand your power to publish and what that does downstream. I guarantee if you're in the federal space or near federal space, when CISA publishes something, the first thing your CISA wants to know, are we protected against this? Have you seen this? And you prioritize a bunch of resources. We're talking thousands of hours across all the organizations here in the DC area, prioritized because CISA published something. When Mandiant or Microsoft puts out a threat blog, the same thing happens, right? You as a threat intel analyst, you need to understand like that impact that you're having on the vendor side to defenders. So we need to be clearer with our assessments because we're spending other people's money every time we hit publish. We are going to, especially on a Friday afternoon, jerks, don't do that, right? We know we're going to spin up resources, especially on an afternoon or a weekend. We need to be clear with our assessments. You know, hat tip to the 578 course. I stole the assessment formula. It's also in their YouTube video, the cycle of cyber threat intelligence that Katie did a few years ago on YouTube. It's really good. But I like this formula where essentially we got to show our math, right? Don't just make your big broad assessment, use your confidence level or your words of probability, right? But actually say, based off of these things, point to what led you there. It's also a really good way to, check your actual biases and, you know, go back towards the title of the talk and confirm with yourself before you publish something, am I actually accurate with this? Or do I just see a bunch of hospitals being attacked? So I assume they're being targeted, right? So you see just a quick example I put at the bottom of the slide, what it should look like, not just say the healthcare is being targeted, but why we think that, and hopefully that will prevent folks from, you know, consuming that, repackaging it with the wrong intent, right? Now it goes from, yeah, we saw a healthcare company be targeted to, you know, major news corporations being like hospitals under attack, right? And then all the pew-pew maps and quote unquote experts on the news. We don't want to go down that path. So show your work. As our consumer, anytime a report says, according to so-and-so's analysis, go find that original report if you can. If it's public, go read that. Then go back and read somebody else's derivative reporting. That will solve a lot of your problems too. Really, really love this quote from General Colin Powell. If you're not an intel person and you're in InfoSec in general, I highly recommend thinking about this anytime you communicate. As an intelligence officer, your responsibility is to tell me what you know, tell me what you don't know, then you're allowed to tell me what you think. But you always keep those three separated. Not sure if you noticed in InfoSec, we all have very strong opinions. Some of ours are loosely held, others hold on to them dearly and tightly. But we're not very good at talking about facts versus feelings. And we need to be communicating that, especially as intelligence officers or intelligence analysts. We need to be communicating what we know from the incident and what we think about the incident, what we don't know, and be very clear in those. We are very easy to jump from, this is what I observed, and China's doing this. And it's like, whoa, that's a thought. That's not actual evidence, right? But we're real strong at that. So try to do your best, especially when communicating to your executive boards, your non-technical leaders, and your stakeholders. They do not know when you're just thinking out loud. They do not know what's evidence-based or not. So we need to be clear, especially, really love these three categories. So the first one was intent-focused. Second one's going to be capabilities focused. So I love what I call like a threat actor playbook. Again, this is one of the CISA reports. I did source it this time. And so to me, like a threat actor playbook, you see some companies starting to pull these online. You also see like a playbook viewer, and it's this idea of showing the MITRE attack techniques. Yeah, take a shot for the MITRE attack team. And then having the actual strings that were observed in the case, right? And so these are really great for threat hunters. The threat intel team produces all these things. Hey, this is this group you want to go prioritize for hunting. Here's a bunch of things we saw. I love these. I do not want to bash on these. These are really, really important. But what happens with these things, and when we talk about threats in general, going back to General Colin Powell's quote, people kind of think that this is everything that we know about this threat actor and that we know everything about this threat actor. In reality, incident data is up until the point that we stop the bad guys and kick them out. If you go trend TTP data from attacks, you're going to notice that it's trends towards the earlier part of the kill chain, where our visibility was better, where the attacks were stopped. We're going to have a lot more phishing detection, hopefully, than C2 detection, or we're really doing things wrong in this community. And so that weights our data, right? That biases our data towards those top techniques being in the earlier part of the kill chain. The other piece is this idea that we have observability. I mean, how many attacks have we seen? We saw some talks here today where the Chinese nation states are really good at hitting edge devices where there's no endpoint detection, there's no bots, or there's no agents, right? There's a lot of blind spots in our networks. There's a lot of blind spots in attacks. And so the concern I have with threat playbooks is that we over-communicate these, that we are really, really smart on this group and we know everything they do, and that people are going to think that they have 110% coverage, not just the marketing team, but the actual people that matter, like your security engineers and your CISO who's got to write the check, right? We don't want to over-communicate our intelligence. I know you're an intelligence analyst. You think you're the smartest person in the room. Stop that. You're not, right? We need to be communicating what we know and what we don't know and not over-promising on these things. Hopefully that makes sense. And if you didn't know you have visibility gaps, you do. Your network's probably got big old blind spots. Most do. So I said, false sense of security here, right? Thinking that we have 100% coverage. You start getting really good, work with your detection engineers, get all this coverage in place. You know, boss starts looking at budget and going, well, I have 110% coverage. Doesn't care about the future attacks. The other piece I've seen with these, and it was cool because, I don't have like mathematical data or statistical data that says like, this is a problem other people see, but I did this version of this talk like 2 weeks ago, and this was the comment that like landed the most, I thought was interesting. How many times we've seen Intel lead an IR case instead of the evidence in IR? I've seen it a handful of times, and I was worried that it was just me, and I had quite a few people say the same thing, that they've experienced the same thing. What happens is because we sound so smart when we go to brief people and we work with the IR team, they start following our Intel, they start following our playbooks and ignoring the evidence that's right there in front of their environment. Threat actors change CTPs. That's why we track them. But we can't bake the IR team or box the IR team into our cute little playbook, right? So if that evidence starts to go a different direction, you put the intel off the side, you follow the IR evidence, right? So we can track new TTPs and also so we can eradicate people. Anybody on the IR side ever work the same actor in the same enterprise twice because they didn't properly get them out the first time? Yeah, like we don't want to box people in the way, this is what the actor did 5 years ago. Right, that would be confirmation bias to actually name a real one, not ones I just made up for the slide deck. So that's a huge problem. I've seen it personally, and it was cool to get feedback that other people have seen that too. And from the nervous chuckles, I can't see past the spotlights. That really is bad. I assume some of you guys have seen that too. So just not getting boxed in and then just not over-promising. Use it to inform. I have used Intel, right, when we do have a visibility gap or we lose the track of the evidence and they're like, Intel, what do you know about this malware family? What do you know about this actor? And like, well, we know they persist and do lateral movement in these ways. And then we're able to go find other ways to track the actor and get back into get back onto the trail and eradicate them. That's a cool use of Intel, but it's not cool if your Intel is going a different direction than IR evidence, okay? That's hard to say together. All right, I'm going super fast. I'll slow down. No, I won't. I'm Italian, the hands go. I try to stay near the podium normally just so I don't pace. So this last one, or this the third one, I don't have a whole lot of slides on. Hunting isn't proactive. I'm sorry. If you read the definition of proactive, no matter what company or vendor blog you pull up, or hunting, it has proactive in there. The reality is you're going to find stuff that's already happened. It feels proactive, and it feels a hell of a lot better than chasing false positive alerts, but it is still a reactive exercise. Yes, you can find visibility gaps while you're hunting and say, hey, we need to patch that gap. The patching effort or getting new visibility, that is very proactive, but the art of hunting, going to find evidence of a bad guy or a bad gal already in your network, they're already in your network, that's still a reactive hunt, okay? I'm sorry. And it's not fronting either. I see you. Threat feeds, we're doing it wrong. Okay, this is a whole nother talk, but from the bias perspective, the reason I wanted to hit on here is how we handle threat information sharing. Take a shot for the FSISAC crew. I was on the DHS, when I was at USCIRT, I was on the Cyber Information Sharing Collaboration Program. A lot of the same pain points. I love what they talked about was like sharing during the incidents and working together in the TLP red zones and the TLP amber zones. But honestly, if you come out to the like vendor side and you see like, everyone's like, give me those threat feeds. I was at an organization, we turned on 71 feeds because that was what our tip vendor offered us by default for free. So we turned them all on, blew up Splunk. It was a horrible day. Actual numbers, I evaluated like 90 days of our response activity to that, and we had seen, one, we were only able to keep up 15% of the alerts that IOC feeds were generating, not the whole SOC, just the intel. We were only able to analyze about 15% of the alerts. I remember it was like 92% of those we should have never looked at. One, we just did stupid things like we were generating alerts for blocked scanned activity. Like, that's probably a cool thing to log so you know your intel's winning, but like not surface to an analyst. So every time someone was scanning outside of the internet and it touched in a threat intel feed, we would get an alert for it. So that was a huge, what I called true positive, but mitigated. And then we had a lot of false positives as well. So it was like 92% of the events, if I remember correctly, or 89, I don't know, all statistics are made up anyway. I have it out in a blog, but it was close to 90% of the events an analyst should have never even looked at. That was 15% of the actual matches that they had in that SOC they were able to look at, and 90% of that 15% was trash. So we're doing things wrong, right? Evaluate your feeds. That's a whole nother conversation on how, but the thing where we get really stupid with threat intel sharing and this whole idea of threat feeds is 99% of the implementations I've seen across probably a few dozen organizations I've worked with over the years, we all bring in threat feeds to generate on new traffic. Very rarely do we ever go look back. And think about that from the, go back to the talk, title talk, or title of the talk, right? Intel fallacies and bias. How dumb that is. Like, do a little critical thinking. I share this thing with you and I said, we saw this last week. And you're like, cool, I'm gonna see if I see it next week. And you don't look last week when we saw the activity. That's why we hate threat intel feeds. We're like, oh, that, you know, kill your IPs after 2 weeks because they're probably dead. They were a cloud IP, you know, or hashes, you know, never changed. So maybe you want to use those for a little bit longer. And we have all these strong affiliate feelings how to implement them for future stuff, but most organizations aren't looking at when the actual activity was reported to have been seen. And that's just dumb to me. You know, I think that's a, it's a huge way we bias our security programs to look in the wrong direction for the wrong stuff. I think intel feeds would have been a lot more successful. One, had we not done the pump and dump and, you know, charged way too much money for people just to get big lists of IP, scanning IPs, but also if we'd implemented them properly from the start, we wouldn't have so many problems. Think critically about your data sources. Think about what is a good block list versus just an alert list or just an enrichment source, right? And you will get way better value out of this, but we actually have to think critically for intel analysts about how we're implementing security and intel into our program. So hopefully that makes sense and I didn't hurt anybody's feelings. All right, so just to recap, right? If I said recap the whole thing, it's just words matter. Read original reporting, try to get past some of that, the derivative bias, because when I read something, I'm gonna change probably the intent if I go to repeat it, right? It's like the adult version of telephone. That's all CTI really is. We all, you know, I heard from the IR team, this is what they saw, blah, blah, blah. So I'm gonna go tell it. I probably dropped off some critical things. Somebody else recaps that report into another derivative report or a blog. They're gonna lose some details that I gave them because they didn't care about them. And then it gets rolled up into a threat profile and it just becomes comma separated list with the same weight. And it's all just eventually becomes noise and everybody starts to hate threat intel, right? Go back to the original reporting, understand the context that matters. And if you're a producer, show your work, actually use the assessment formula. There's a lot of great training material out on CTI now. Let's start using it. Like, let's actually start maturing and standardizing how we do things. I don't know about you. I came into this field. There was like zero training for CTI. And if you were lucky, the grumpy old guy would actually show you what he did and not just be a jerk about it, like read the manual. So I really love the fact, one, we're doing this here at the summit. Really love the fact you guys have the track for noobs coming into intel. But as producers, we need to do better at standardizing how we share in some of the words. So like, remember that, like, you know, I just threw that together as a kind of an idea, the target of spectrum of targeting, right? Let's be clear in the type of activity that we're seeing so that people can make more informed decisions. No, let's not just, I love focusing on techniques. I love the threat actor playbook. But let's not just focus on assessing the InfoSec side. Otherwise, we're not really threat intel analysts. We're just IR, like daily journals, really. So we do need to do those intel assessments, but we need to show our work when we do it. Don't just make a big, bold claim. I would highly recommend the key assumptions check as a way to combat some of those biases. So if you don't know, this is a standard structured analytical technique, SAT, not that horrible thing you did in high school. The key assumptions check I love, it's really good for intel analysts, it's really good for IR practitioners, it's really good for detection engineers, really good for anybody who's trying to think critically. And that is list out all your evidence and your assumptions about those and ask yourself throughout phases, right? If you're doing IR, follow the phases of IR. If you're doing intel, do it as you're writing things, but check those key assumptions. Did you get new evidence that contradicted some of the previous thoughts that you had, right? Or contradicted previous evidence? I think the better we get at actually honestly kind of mapping that out, and to me, like, the key assumptions check method is basically the implementation of General Colin Powell's quote, is like, we're listing out what we know and what we think about it and where our gaps are, and we're reevaluating that. But it's important not to just do that as evidence comes in. It's important to do that throughout the phases and compare the evidence against each other. The Olympic destroyer is a great example. I know the misattribution thing was talked about for years. If you're newer to the field, it was one of the Olympics, I don't know, somewhere between a month and 10 years ago, because cyber time is a blur. But there was a lot of, like, you know, misleading things in the code and trying to do misattribution in the code. And, you know, there was quite a few early reports because everybody wanted to publish first. They got it wrong. We actually take a step, slow down. I know that's funny coming from the fast talking guy. Slow down and actually evaluate our assumptions and say, what is our evidence actually telling us? Does it contradict? Do I still want to, you know, is this still accurate? It is important to share fast, to the FSISAC's point, right? When a case is going, you share what you know. It's okay then to follow up and say, hey, we were wrong. Just make sure you follow up and say you're wrong. Don't just leave the bad data out there. But always evaluate where you're at throughout the phases of IR or intel before you publish. You know, get it a sanity check, not just commas and periods. I will tell you, the most terrifying thing I've ever done was publish a thing to the internet under US Search brand, and I'm glad my name is not on it. It was actually a good report, but it was still super terrifying. And the only feedback I got from my peers was commas, periods, and looks good. Like, no one challenged my analysis, and we were coming out to name a threat group for one of the first times ever to name a nation from US Search. Now it's pretty common for them. This was one of the first times, and literally my fellow threat analysts, no one challenged my assumptions. No one challenged my assessments at all. And I was just like, they told me it was going to publish by 4. And I'm like running a streak through my phone, just trying to get the page to refresh to see when it went up. It was super terrifying. So, you know, be comfortable challenging yourself and be comfortable challenging your peers too. It's really hard to get feedback, but that's going to make our intel heck of a lot better. I do have a bunch of acknowledgments in here. The first line, obviously you all know Katie since she was part of the kickoff, but John and Joe and Katie, I really want to give them a shout out, because there's a lot of great content coming out in intel. There's not a lot of great content over the years that has come out about, like, how to do the thing that we do. And they've done really, really well to contribute to the community on actually, like, what our processes look like in CTI. Joe has an amazing white paper. I think it was from Domain Tools or Gigamon back in the day about, like, how to do infrastructure hunting. John's been doing this stuff with the CTI career field. And I really, really appreciate anybody who gives back to the field beyond just analysis, but, like, here's how to do the job. That's really huge. And a bunch of my other friends and nerds that have supported me throughout my career. One last quote that I absolutely love. Without data, you're just another person with an opinion, right? So again, show your work. And with that, I know I went super fast. I'm done, no more phrasing.
You're not done.
But I do have Killer Grizz stickers over here, the little pink bear, that's my dumb logo.
Do you guys think you're going to hear roasting of the threat intelligence space to close out the day in a very positive way? I will tell you one thing, it's got a lot of chatter, is your definition of threat hunting. A lot of people challenge you on that.
I will also say threat hunting is done inside the perimeter. What you do in, like, virus total and domain tools is called intel collection. It's not hunting. I will fight people on that one too. Hill,
okay, we're not going to be fighting here. That is in the hallway activity.
It's not proactive though.
So I have another, actually, and you have the iPad with all the questions, but I'm going to ask one thing. This is something that I think we talked about a few summits ago, another kind of bias or fallacy, which is the security conference fallacy, which means that it looks like there's a whole lot of activity coming out just because all the vendors are pushing to get their reporting, so they have something to talk about with people at conferences. Is that something you've seen? And if so, how do you think we might be able to counter that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you see researchers, whether they want to or not, have to hoard data up until a conference so that the marketing guys can or gals can get their big blogs out and their click rates. I mean, it's hard. As an organizer of a con too, right? I help run B-Sides Nova. We have that problem of, like, if you do it right after DEF CON, did all the great research come out already? I will say, find a place to share. Don't hoard it for conferences. Start your own blog. It's easy to do on Medium or your own website for cheap. It's much better to get the research out there and then get the opportunity to speak at a con to bring light to it. But, the data hoarding, especially if it's incident data, think about that. This is one of the things that kills me about intel. If I'm holding on to incident data until I have the complete picture because I don't want to be wrong early, and other organizations are being breached, I should be at risk of that, right? Like, that is a jerk move to hoard data because you don't want to be wrong or you're waiting for a conference. If you're seeing activity, like, people are like, oh, you're going to burn your access. Don't care. Same thing with my attribution thing. Like, on the defender side, don't really care who. I've been shot at a lot in Iraq and never cared who it was. I just wanted it to stop, right? Like, share your stuff. Get your blog out there. Don't just wait for a con.
There's a term I used to describe that. We actually had a – it was right after the ABT1 report where people were talking about adversaries' response to threat research. There's a concept called intel gain loss. So people that come from traditional intel background will get that. I call it marketing gain loss when it's on the vendor side and the vendor's wanting to get, I've worked for vendors, so I get it, but yep. There is an aspect of building the brand, getting emails into a database and stuff. I like your approach, like something bad's happening, get it out to the community.
Yeah, and also too, I mean, you know, to push back on the marketing folks, what are we gonna publish the week before RSA with everybody else and get that research buried? Like, that's a crappy move to the analysts who worked a lot of work on that, so.
Do you have any hot opinions on estimative language?
Yeah, I don't see it really outside of the government. That's the thing about CTI space I've seen. A lot of us either come from traditional intel community training and then we have a lot of that structure and we kind of let it die when we leave, or we don't, and then we don't do very well on the defender side because we're like, what are your intel requirements? And your CISO's like, what the hell is that?
What is your PIR?
Right. And the other, what elements of friendly information, whatever the hell DOD calls those. Or the other piece is folks that came up from IR and saw too many of the same activity, realized it was probably a group and started to cluster it. And so I think like there's a really good opportunity for us to kind of cross-pollinate our skills, and we haven't done a very good job of that as a CTI community. You either a really good kind of threat intel IR type support person, or you've got the structure, and I haven't seen only a handful of, you know, kind of unicorns in the field do both and have the good structure analytical techniques. Like, I love teaching them. I love talking about them in CTI 101 workshops, but I've very rarely ever seen teams use them.
What's your favorite structured analytic technique?
Key assumptions check, because it's easy.
That's my favorite.
What's your favorite one that wasn't on your slides?
That's the only one I use, honestly.
Well, you can do a SWOT. Like, if people are trying to do SATs, a SWOT is externalizing thinking. So you don't have to do ACHs, and, you know, there's literally hundreds of SATs that you could do. You know, key assumption check is easy. A SWOT is easy.
I like red team analysis too, because I'm kind of contrarian sometimes and like to be a jerk and challenge assumptions. So like red team analysis and, like, you know, kind of asking the seven whys, those types of things, or five whys, whatever it is. I think those really help.
Why don't we see if anyone in the room, we got any lights? I see a hand back there. There's a lightsaber.
Yeah, that's all you can see.
Thank you again for the great presentation. I really liked your first fallacy on the word targeted. I'm curious if you could elaborate a little bit more on when is it appropriate to use the word targeted? So what would your definition be, and what would that threshold be for a defender to say that the activity was targeted versus incidental or just part of a broader campaign against?
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm okay with using the word targeted if we're kind of like words of estimate of probability, like if we're using like a spectrum of targeting, like, do we think it's target of opportunity? I think a lot of people aren't doing that analysis and we're jumping right over that. So if you're gonna use the word targeting, I would just say, you know, show your evidence of why, right? So if we see, you know, for all of you that run URLs, phishing URLs through VirusTotal without redacting the parameters, and I can see all the other organizations that got the same email, thank you. That's bad OPSEC, but thank you. Like, when I run that phishing URL and I see 10 other organizations got that, I'm like, okay, we probably weren't targeted. This was probably a big phishing list, right? You can also do that based off the intel group if you know the type of activity they do. If you know a big vulnerabilities out there and the whole world's getting scanned and you see a bunch of different industries being popped at the same time, using the word targeted outside of the words target of opportunity may be a bit, you know, biasing the data or maybe a little untrue.
Oh, we got another question over there. Yep, go ahead. Oh, yeah, over here.
Go ahead, anybody.
Yes, you.
Hi, thank you. The presentation was very cathartic. first of all, second of all, how would you change your advice for smaller teams with, like, you know, one or two people in the shop, right? And then they have like very limited analytical capacity, right? And they're always bombarded by, you know, current intelligence, tyranny and current intelligence, and they just have not a lot of time to, you know, basically really make sure they check their own biases and all.
Yeah, it's harder with smaller teams. I mean, at a minimum, I would like to see like minimum team size be like three, so that you do have a little diversity in thought, but I understand budget. Sometimes it's the IR person is also the threat hunter, also the intel person. I just think they need to lean on their peers that maybe not the intel, but ask for that sanity check and explain what they were thinking. I mean, honestly, I think part of it is us being comfortable with being wrong. Like I see in intel teams a lot, y'all hoard data. Like it's the weirdest thing. Like I don't want to share this with my other intel analysts. I don't know which intel community agency you came from, CIA. You were, seems like you were abused in there. but like share with your team. Like red ink is not a bad thing, right? Like we're just trying to make the product better. We're trying to make our organization better. Like, so, but if you don't have other intel folks, I mean, you have IR, you have SOC, and honestly, go to your SOC, go to your IR folks and ask if your intel sucks. Like we need to be honest with each other.
I'd add on to that. Like leadership needs to model being okay to be challenged. Yep. and set up an environment for the intel teams to do it in a constructive way. Sherman, nice plug to talk, by the way. I saw that.
Yeah, over there in the corner.
Oh, that's me. Okay, awesome. Yeah, longtime listener, first time caller. Great talk. And funny enough, we're talking about biases. Like, I think we're hitting a group thing because Sherman hit like almost my exact question, but a little bit of a deviation here. So a lot of what you're talking about is really interesting principles and almost like a culture of an intel shop. But from the top down, it's easy to be like, "Hey, thou shalt do this." What would be your advice from the bottom up? Like if you're just an analyst and you're like, hey, I want to do a lot of this and I'm seeing these patterns, but it's kind of hard to get traction. How do you kind of, I guess, lead up with some of these ideas and some of these changes?
Just do it. That's how I started my career. I mean, my first time I started as a threat analyst, I had a bunch of folks on the team. I thought I was going to learn a bunch from them. They all hoarded data, wouldn't show me how to do the thing. So I did it myself and like, within 6 months, I'm supposed to be on night shift. A client asked me to be back down on day shift, and I became a leader of the teams because I was willing to work with other people. Like this whole closed mindset thing still exists in CTI, but folks that get promoted and get ahead are like actually sharing their experiences and trying. And I'm just really good at going over and around speed bumps if I have to. Tell me no, bet.
Go to Lincoln.
Thanks, good talk. You mentioned that most CTI teams aren't doing historic look backs on their threat feeds. Why do you think that is? And what are the challenges that are holding teams back from doing this at scale? And following, like, what recommendations do you have for teams to?
So part of it's a technology problem. I mean, I don't know all of the seams and integrations out there, but when I was doing this stuff about 2 years ago in a SOC, the apps were being built by Splunk or for Splunk by the threat intel vendors. They were all designed to look forward. And when we were like, hey, I want to take everything that came in the last 24 hours or was modified in the last 24 hours, and I want to just run it as a cron job at night, even then our engineers were like, oh, that's going to crash the system. And I was like, that's crazy because we run that kind of data computing all of the time with other queries. But it really did start to run into problems. One, again, we turned on way too many threat feeds. But yeah, it just seems like, and I'll kick vendors in the butt here as a vendor, like we built a bunch of solutions without a problem. We just built more problems. What I've seen is most teams end up like writing their own custom cron jobs that run every night and sync the system at 2 a.m. when hopefully no one's online. So,
hello. Hi. Based on your experience, when a threat intelligence feed is good, based on your experience, right?
I go back to say I kind of hate intel sometimes because of the threat intel feed experience. I will say it's less about the threat intel feed being good or bad. It's more about us as consumers knowing what we're bringing in. I mean, a big part of the intel community is like source assessment. And then we get into CTI and we're like, turn on the pipe, right? Like we should be assessing every one of our feeds, even from the same vendor, right? Like I know we used to integrate Mandiant when I was in government SOX. They had like 8 or 9 different feeds. When we talked to them after a whole bunch of false positives, we're like, yeah, no, you should not be generating alerts from this. That was not the intent of that feed. Like talk to your vendors, right? Actually ask for their recommendations. I think there's kind of 3 categories for integrating those. It's stuff that should be a block list, stuff that should be a watch list, and stuff that's been an enrichment. I know an organization was burned so many times. They use their intel, and this should be a knock on us as intel producers, not on them. They only use their intel as enrichment for an ongoing IR. They do not generate any events from it. When they have an IR case, they'll run their IOCs against intel, and if malware shows up, a malware name shows up or an actor name shows up, then they'll loop the intel into the case. Otherwise, they don't ever look at their commercial providers because we've burned them too many times with false positives. And even if it's free, if it costs 3-4 fake cases, we're costing them money now. So even free feeds cost. Got another green wand.
We Wait a minute. Hold on. Hold on. I got to plug a talk from Becca many years ago when she said OSINT in particular was free, as in puppies, which I think if somebody gives you a puppy, you know there's absolutely nothing free about it, and it's not low maintenance. So I think that's one of the best quotes we've
had.
That
was my first time talking at CTI Summit.
That's an awesome quote, too.
I quote it all the time, actually. And then tribute.
Thank you. Yeah, we've got one in the back over there.
Hey, Andy, thank you so much. First of all, 1,000 points for the Archer gifts. You win everything. One of our weird challenges we're focusing on right now is my leadership actually is a great ingester of threat intelligence. And then he comes to me and goes, what are we doing about China? And I keep telling him, China's just not that into you. And he just cannot combat the fact that he's like, well, all these reports, all these things. So we're sort of dealing with the fallacy from a customer standpoint. So what recommendation do you have to sort of convince him that that targeting isn't necessarily targeted?
So I'm going to be a jerk and plug my own research. I did the master's program. So use a threat model, right? It's called Threat Box. I have a blog version, so you don't have to read the academic paper version. But it's build a threat model, right? Of which organization, which groups do you actually care about and why? And I know the same thing, like Russia, Ukraine popped off. That was the number one RFI from all of our customers. What's happening? Is Russia going to care about us? How do we protect ourselves? And you're like, your small, medium business in the Midwest not doing anything with the DOD or Western Europe, you probably don't have to worry. I will say, though, it's very easy for us, again, strongly opinionated in InfoSec, to be dismissive of those RFIs. Our job isn't just to raise the alarm. We can lower the alarm, too. It's a great opportunity to educate your boss and say, hey, I hear you. Here's all the things that we think and why we're not really concerned about them. So try not to be dismissive. I know it's been, if you get it 3 or 4 times from the same person, it might be harder, but I see that a lot when again, Russia, Ukraine popped off, a lot of my threat analysts were like, oh, that company doesn't need to worry about that. I'm like, then let's tell them and tell them why, right? Like, people have no idea. I think we often get kind of a, not to call us all subject matter experts, but like the SME bias, we forget that other people don't know what we know. And we're like, well, you're an idiot for not knowing that thing. They can run a business. I can't, right? They think I'm an idiot every time we try to talk about finances. And I'm like, I can't count that high without taking my shoes off. So they are smarter than me in other pieces, right? So just like swallow pride. And I think if you have a threat model, organizational threat model, and you lay that out and it's something you brief them regularly on, that will help a lot of the noise too. I mean, I unfortunately, my old job sat right next to the conference rooms that the CISO had to walk by to all of his meetings. And so he'd be like, hey, Andy, who do I need to care about today? That's why I created the threat box, was to answer that dumb question every day. Who should I care about today? Like, it just changed overnight.
Do we have any more questions in the room?
Sorry, Greg, I really liked working for you. He was an awesome CISO.
All right, well, I think with that.
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you for taking us home.